Great. So thank you for everyone that's attended this session. My name is Mike Omega. I'm joined by my colleague Marcy here. So we will be moderating the session, the masterclass rather on, nature-inspired innovation that's being facilitated by the biomimicry team in India. So I'd just like to introduce our speakers today, starting by Prashant. So Prashant works with the Biomimicry India Network and Biomimicry India. He holds a degree in MS, Master of Science in Biomimicry from the Arizona State University, US, a Biomimicry Professional Certificate from Biomimicry 3.8, still in US. He is an architect and holds a degree in architecture from SPA Delhi and an MBA from ISB Hyderabad. Prashant prefers to call himself an amateur researcher of issues related to suitable happiness. So Prashant is also joined by Seema Anand. She is also a biomimicry specialist and is practicing architecture as well in Bangalore. She is the co-founder of Biomimicry India Network and also the founder of Biomimicry India, a company which consults and undertakes research in the field of biomimicry. She considers biomimicry as a lighthouse that can successfully guide our approach to sustainable designs. So Seema and Prashant have been developing biomimicry programs, promoting and conducting biomimicry networks, and taking, talks in India for the last 18 years. As of today, Biomimicry India has conducted more than 145 biomimicry workshop talks and reached more than 25,000 people across media. Biomimicry workshops are probably the only programs that has demonstrated a program being taught successfully across disciplines, age groups, and multidisciplinary formats. The organizations that they have served include Rolls-Royce, Mahindra and Mahindra, Axis Bank, SPA Delhi, CEPT University, Anand Fellowship Program in Ahmedabad. Ahmedabad. And the NCBS Bangalore, Sishu Griha, as well as the Agastya International Foundation, Sri Adwanand Public School, among others. Seema and Prashant believe and advocate that biomimicry approach should be integrated in all education and industry practices as it holds the promise and keys for sustainable development. So I'd just like to hand it over to Prashant and Seema to take it away with the masterclass. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael. Thank you for the nice, very kind introduction.
So without taking too much time, we will share our screen and begin the journey into biomimicry, which might be a new subject for many of you. And I'm sure a few of you will already know. So as we just want to see if you can see our screen, can you just show us a thumbs up if the screen is visible? Okay, so biomimicry, nature-inspired design. We're just trying to change. So broadly, we have 1 hour and we just wanted to set your expectations.
We have 2 hours. We promise you won't be bored. We've never let down anybody. We've even had 8 hour workshops. So here's the schedule. We are going to begin by briefly introducing what is biomimicry, why now, and the most important question, what's in it for me? Because we believe that the industrial Homo sapien, I think that's a new species we are all part of, is driven by that question, what's in it for me? So we are going to take that question head on, that what's in it for you and why is it important right now? Then we'll take a brief journey into the technology in biology. And after that, we'll have a short question and answer session. Feel free to keep your questions, you can write them down and send them. I would request if Michael can moderate, or if there are very few, then maybe we can directly answer them. After that, we go to the next session where we will try and go deeper into biomimicry, because a lot of the questions which people want to know is that all this sounds good. How do you apply it? What does it make economic sense to me in my life, in my my professional journey? So we are going to take certain questions which are very industrial in terms of procurement, design, manufacturing or construction, maintenance or operations, or you can say management, as well as waste. Broadly, it covers the life cycle of whether you are running a service industry, an NGO, or in many ways, and try and see what we can learn from nature. And then we'll try to validate it with some case study so that it becomes more vivid, that how are these shifts happening and where are the gaps and opportunities for today's businesses and today's institutions to start moving in a direction which is in alignment with nature. Towards the end, we will also show a few case studies of our own students. We usually do that because people feel that all this sounds exotic. Has anything been done? So the good news is a lot of things are being done. And we're going to show those case studies. And after that, we'll have another session of question and answers. So that's the agenda for the day. So let's begin. So what you see on your screen, you see some accidents, right? Now you see that two cars have banged into each other. A cycle has banged into a car, trains. Now, if we put our hand on our hearts, even in this COVID situation, I promise you, Homo sapiens somewhere in the world, thousands of them are having accidents. Is that correct? I'm sure it is correct. It is 100% true. Now let's look at this other slide, other graphic. These are a flock of birds. They are a flock of locusts. There's a shoal of fish, something which you can probably see out of your window, or you've seen it very regularly every day, most of your life. Can you please tell me how many accidents have you seen or reported? How many birds have had an accident with each other? And you said today 15 birds collided into each other and fell down, 15 fish or locusts? None, right? Do we want to believe that the technology of navigation that we have has rules which are different for these two things? Clearly, the rules of that operate on the universe, Earth, are the same, whether it you are a bird or you are in a car. In fact, the human species has more sophisticated rules. We have red lights, we have navigation, we have police, yet we come into accidents. We might not have the answer, but shouldn't we have the question, how do these flocks of birds do it? How come they never have an accident? Now, this is where biomimicry becomes important, that we have become so economy present that we might have become place blind. There are solutions right around us, but we have stopped noticing them. And it's time that we reawaken our ability to see sophisticated earth-friendly solutions. Now, interestingly, these technologies are called swarm technologies, and science is already studying these technologies, including companies like Volvo to develop driverless cars. Now, you see this other graphic, there is a pothole. Now, from where I come from, India, you know, these things are very regular. Our roads break down, and when they break down, to get them repaired is a big problem. The public has to protest, there are accidents that happen. Then the government decides it needs many reports, and then it comes in for tenders. My God, it takes months. Let's look at this other slide. This is a termite mound. I'm sure all of you have seen a termite mound near your house or somewhere or the other. Now, don't go and break a termite mound. But if you find that if a termite mound gets a little damaged or broken, and you come back to that termite mound after say 4 or 5 hours or maybe a day or two, you'll find it's been repaired. Might not be the same shape. See, the problem is the same. In a termite mound also, there are hundreds of thousands of termites like individuals living together. It's common property. They also have the same problem. Oh, this has got damage. Do I have to repair it or will he repair it? Do I need a sanction report? Who will give me the sanction? Who's the supervisor? Where's the blueprint? Same problems that we face, right? Yet they are able to repair it. Shouldn't we at least be wondering, how do they do it? Well, you know, biology knows how they do it. It's a system of decentralized decision making, decentralized resources, decentralization of know-how. Now, once we begin to understand design principle, we say, oh, we could have done that. But that's what I'm trying to provoke, is that there are so many things that are happening which are solving problems which we are facing. Let's take this new, the next slide. Now, how many of us have seen ants? I promise you, somewhere, wherever you are, might be sitting within 300 to 400 meters of you, ants are busy doing what ants do. Now, have you ever wondered how come ants have survived so long? In fact, ants are a more successful species on Earth than humanity in terms of biomass. And they have a much more unpredictable environment than we do. Now, let me tell you one thing. They work in teams of hundreds of thousands, correct? Do you think that these teams are not taking decisions? Obviously, these teams are taking decisions. They have to decide, is this where we build our nest? Where do we go foraging for food? And these teams have to agree on tasks and accomplish tasks. That's the only way they have survived, and they are still surviving. Now, how many of us have worked in teams? Even in a team of five, how difficult it is to align everybody's behavior along one purpose. Isn't this a big problem humanity faces? How do we align behavior along common purposes? At least we should have the curiosity. How are these ants able to do it? Hundreds and thousands of individuals, by the way, or each ant is an independent, selfish individual like us. Take an ant alone, it will fight to survive. Yet they are able to align their behavior along a common purpose. And let me give you a secret. Unlike us, the ants do not have a hierarchy of bosses. Wouldn't you love to have a bossless society? Self-organized. So this is self-organization. I think humanity has reached a stage where we should understand how does self-organization work. And interestingly, a lot of the technology that you and I are today using is actually being inspired by algorithms, which the scientists have learned from ants. And this includes how bandwidth is allocated by a router. Do you know it was inspired by ants? And there are many other technologies. So let's look at this other thing. Again, maybe outside your window, you've seen a beehive. What a marvel of engineering. Without any blueprint or a supervisor or an architect. One of the most sophisticated design, and this design is extremely lightweight, made out of wax. It has to deal with wind, humidity, heat. Yet it survived much better than anything that humanity has created. And this is biodegradable. You can eat it. Now imagine this technology exists, but just because this technology is not being given in our textbook, we have lost our sense of wonder and sense of inquiry. Clearly, and let me tell you one more thing. It has been found by scientists that in the jungles, bees have to decide where to locate the nest. If they get the decision wrong, it's not a trivial thing. The entire thing can die. It is said that their decision is almost 97% correct. Now imagine humanity. Some of our best specimens were promoted to become investment bankers, and we know what investment banking has done to us. So it would have been better to make the bees our investment bankers, isn't it? So how does collective decision making create such decisions? We should start wondering. And let me share with you, cutting edge science is already looking into this, and a lot of things that we are simply consuming might be coming from biology. Similarly, we talk about disasters and resilience. Now, have you ever, in 3.8 billion years of living systems, life has been thriving, and not thriving not because there are there are wildfires. Even right now, the world has so many wildfires. There are earthquakes. Yet a forest or an ecosystem restores. But our systems are so rigid that they are unable to restore. Also, today we are planning to build cities. But our cities are always in conflict, aren't they? I want you to keep your hand on your heart, go to a city court, you will see 50%, at least in India, 90% of the litigation has to do with property related matters. So clearly, something that we are doing is not right. But how does a forest emerge? A forest also has so many millions and billions of species which live together. All of them are autonomous, individual free will, yet integrated. Nature follows the rules of emergence. While humanity is trying to create a master plan and trying to predict what will happen in 5 years, and that's not the way life works. So can we create something which is more emergent? And as I speak to you, already in master planning, some of the leading engineering organizations are looking at taking inspiration from nature. So we've been hearing these big words called circular economy, zero waste. Now, are they new? Just look at the forest near you. You know, nothing. Have you ever seen waste in a forest, a billion-year-old forest? Waste is a human invention. We are not so great a species. We have invented waste. And we are trying to say circular economy. It's not a new concept. It's already there in nature. What I'm trying to say is that we intellectually think we are doing some great things, discovering new concepts. No, we are just awakening to the way nature works. Nature has always had a circular economy, zero waste systems. Now let's look at this. Have you seen a pine cone? I'm sure a lot of us have seen pine cones, painted pine cones, and kicked them around. But you know, a pine cone, if it's not damaged, if you put it in moisture, it will automatically close even without an electrical wire or being attached to a tree. And if you put it in a dry position, it will automatically open up. This is self-actuated materials, smart material, which we are talking. So it has always been there. And what it's doing is it's a very smart way of regulating heat and moisture. Isn't that what we want to do in our buildings? Imagine if our louvers and our windows could do that, and without electricity or anything. So these are examples around us. Let's look at this next graphic. One of our biggest problem, packaging. In fact, waste, one of the biggest problems. The same thing, a pine cone is also a packaging material, but it's a packaging material. Number one, it's biodegradable. Number two, it is managing to physically protect the seeds from moisture and other things without any electrical or other things. We think our packaging is smart. Now tell me, how smart is our packaging? Isn't the pine cone a much better packaging system? So the challenge is, we can say we do not know how to do it, but to say that we will not even see what is happening in November 2020, I think is an unforgivable problem of humanity, because our education, which has helped open doors, might also have become our prison today. We have to be careful that there is, education is not only in the books. Our biggest library is the nature around us. Another big problem is desalination. I'm sure many of you eat fish, or you know, some of us eat mangrove-based plants. Now, fishes are in saline water. Most of the fishes come from saline water. But when we eat fish, we digest it, and human, we can't digest saline water. Which says that the technology of desalination was always on our plate for thousands of years. Just that we lost our curiosity to say, how does the fish desalinate that water? The good news is that the scientists are today figuring out how it's done, and it is now becoming part of our solution process. Similarly, we talk about sequestering carbon. Oh, what a big concept. It's not a new concept. That's the way Earth has been operating for millions and millions of years. Your coral reefs, your trees, your forests, your soil, they have been sequestering carbons for billions of years, keeping the system in balance. Can't we learn from that? So, and now let's come to the COVID situation to make it more real for you. We are not even the first one to do social distancing. There is a species of termite called damput termite. When it gets infected, then it autonomously will keep a distance from the colony, and it will signal to them that don't come near me. So my friends, we are not the smartest species. Similarly, there is a species of ants called fire ants. When their colony gets infected by pathogens, they bring raisins from a tree and use it as a sanitizer around their nest or on each other. So I'm sorry, we are not the first ones to think up of sanitizers. We are just copying nature in any case without realizing. And the other thing, there is another species of an ant called Lasius neglectus. When they get infected, now instead of isolating an individual, which has got infected, they actually remove its infection, and a slight bit of it they also get, which they spread in the entire colony, in many ways giving everybody a low level of infection, thereby helping everybody to get immunity. Isn't that vaccination or herd immunity that we are talking about? So we are not the first ones to think of these things. Why I wanted to begin with this is, let's begin with deep humility, that nature has already solved many of the problems we grapple with today. The question is, how do we browse this library of solutions? How do we use these problems? The interesting thing is that while nature is solving this problem, it is creating zero waste, zero pollution, and keeping the system in balance. Often our solutions, while they solve one problem, they create another problem. And that's where we have to start looking at nature. We cannot afford unintended consequences. So this, we say, is awakening to biomimicry. What is biomimicry? It is understanding how nature is doing the same solution, but without harming anything. And we call it the biggest library on this earth. And the great thing is that nature, none of the organism in nature have applied for intellectual property right. So they will not sue you. If you copy from nature, you will not get a notice. And what an opportunity for all of us, that here is a free resource. And we feel that we can't solve our problem. We have to start shifting our gaze. And the most important thing is that there is only one design brief which a lot of scientists have agreed upon that nature has, that is, say, create conditions conducive to life, life with a capital L, all life, not just human life. So if you are aligned to that principle, whether it's a technology or a policy or an institution, it is fine. And it is very important for humanity to agree to a common principle today. Otherwise, we have brilliance, but I always say that it seems like a cacophony of brilliance. Individually brilliant, whether it's your engineering, your science, your politics, but together, it doesn't make any coherent sense. Who is going to give us the script for coherence? It is our belief that it is nature. And this, if we all agree on this single principle that create conditions conducive to life, we can, with the limited resources, we can create abundance. And with this, I give the mic to Seema to take us through that, how nature has been doing it for billions of years.
So hi, everyone. So what's an introduction without a small history recap? So this is really about, I'm going to quickly take you through 3.8 billion years of life, when life really emerged on the planet, which is 4.5 billion years old. So what all has happened? How has life emerge, creating one condition after the other, which is made possible for other life to happen, or more life to happen, more complex life to happen. So as you know, the planet is 4.5 billion years old. And to make it simpler, not to talk in billions and millions, what we've done is, like any evolutionary biologist, we've compressed it into 1 year, where each day stands for, as you can see, 12.32 million years. And Earth was born on this calendar year on 1st of January. And today, on 6th November 2020, we are all sitting here, which is 31st December midnight. So just before the year is getting over. So in this calendar year, how has life unfolded? What happened? What was the sequence of events? So let me quickly take you through that. So life really happened on 25th February, which was when the first organism, these are just microorganisms, these are really small bacteria. The great thing about them is that they're still around today. And what is the secret of their success? That they continuously evolve and adapt to the changing conditions of the planet, which many other organisms you'll see were not able to do. So this is really their success strategy. And in March 28th is when this innovation happened, which is photosynthesis. So this is where the carbon sequestering that Prashant was talking about, some organisms learn how to take sunlight, mix it with water and carbon dioxide, and turn it into another form of energy, which is sugar, on which a lot of other life forms to come in future would depend, use it as their energy source and survive better. So this is an event in this time span where it's not just physical elements are affecting life. Actually, life is changing the physical nature of the planet because it's creating oxygen. It's taking in carbon dioxide, releasing oxygen into the air and creating this thin layer of ozone in the atmosphere, which is creating conditions even better for other life forms to happen. And for a long time, till August 16th, it was the micro, this at a cellular level, how life was constantly becoming more and more complex, evolving, and a lot of R&D in this calendar year has really happened at the nano scale, at the cellular scale. And today when we are talking about nanotechnology, we know how evolved that is in the living form. And we really want to, no matter what profession you are in, this is where our real energy and focus should be, because today we have the tools and methods to look at nanotechnology. Whether you're an architect, engineer, we have the tools, we have the technology to learn and develop ideas at a nano scale. So this is where life invested a lot. And only on August 16th did two cells, now this is the first time two cells learn to cohabit and exchange benefits and resources to help each other survive better. And this is not just a lesson back then, actually our own body, which we might think is really ours, but if you ask the scientists, actually our cells in our body is actually just 10 to 15%. The rest is all other organisms that cohabit in our body. So we are a living ecosystem ourselves, whether it is our gut. So many bacteria, because they learn to exchange benefits with us. We eat food, they digest it for us. So it helps them live better. And they have been living for millions of years because of us. And we have survived. We have learned to digest many kinds of food and get energy from them because of this symbiotic collaborative relationship. So this is when cooperation really started between living organisms at a microscopic scale.
Yeah, I just want to add for all the business people, this was the first partnership experiment where two people, two different entities entered into an agreement. If you don't trust me, the word organization, what is the root word? Organelle, organ, it comes from biology. Often we miss out. But hey, it started from here. So this is your first partnership firm.
And on September 17th is for when first sexual reproduction happens. So this is not no more cell dividing into, dividing itself into more cells. This is two cells learn to exchange genes. And this led to many, many more complex life forms to happen. So this is a very important event in this calendar year. And so why is this really important? Because suddenly from one cell being perfect, so Six Sigma protection was happening. If that was the perfect way to propagate, to reproduce, to survive, that should have continued. But here, a lot of exchange of genes is happening. There's a diverse form of life form that is coming on the planet. And that led to what we call diverse living forms. And how does that help? Because conditions on the planet are not constant. They keep changing. And a greater diversity helps better survival. So today when we say diversify your business, diversify your skill sets, actually life learned that around September, that I better dive. It's not by design, it's by evolution that you have to diversify into various kind of organisms, which helps you survive better and better to the changing conditions.
Yeah, and let me give you one more secret. So what is, now life also has a stock you know, has an accounting problem. Initially, it was so simple. You have 4 or 5 species. Each species is the same. Just keep a number. Now, every species becomes different. You know, the same problem that we are facing as humans. You need a unique identity. Why do you need a fingerprint? Because you are unique. Although we are all humans, we are all unique. This is the culprit. If it wasn't for sexual reproduction, we would all be the same. No problem. You know, same stock. But why would life do it? So as Seema said, life did it because life, it is decentralization, diversity. That's what enables resilience. But at the same time, you have an account keeping problem. How do you track all this? So I'm going to give you another secret. What did life do? When two parties are transacting, so two chromosomes meet, a new chromosome is created. That chromosome has all the information of party A, party B. And that chromosome is stored in a distributed, decentralized network of our cells. Now, is it sounding familiar? This is your original blockchain, but way more sophisticated than the blockchain we think we have invented. This is more than 1.5 billion year old. So a lot of things we feel we are inventing have been invented in a way more sophisticated way in life.
So this is biomimicry at a systems level.
And on November 15, we had mycelium, or what we know popularly as fungi. So mycelium, what you see as mushrooms or we eat as mushroom is just part of that organism. It is actually one of the largest organism on this planet, and it is under the forest bed. And it really has a symbiotic relationship with all the trees and plants, and it helps distribute resources, whether it's water, nutrients, even information. So if there is a pest attack on one part of the forest, it actually sends signal to the rest of the forest so that they can release the right chemicals to protect themselves. So this is the Wood Wide Web. It's been nicknamed as Wood Wide Web. Like our World Wide Web, this is the exchange system. This is the internet of the natural ecosystems, which help them, you know, work better, exchange information like we do. When we work in a big team today, we are able to exchange this information through this World Wide Web. This is how the natural systems innovated on this on November 15th, so millions of years ago.
Yeah. And in many ways, it is setting the stage for life to come onto land.
And on November 22nd, we had land plants, which, I mean, as you know, life started in water, but on land, the conditions were not very conducive for much life to happen because of harsh sunlight, of course, less oxygen. And when land plants happened, they adapted to different biomes, whether it was very cold, very hot, less water, more water, and they created more conditions conducive to other life forms to happen. So how biological life is creating, changing the physical nature of the planet so that more life forms have a chance of survival. And we had reptiles, life started crawling out of water. So reptiles are some of the best water management, have this best water management strategy. So anybody studying water, these are the organisms you need to look at, that how they collect water from their local environment, whatever is abundant, whether it's in a vapor form or liquid form, how do they store it? How do they manage it? Their body systems are some of these organisms who live in desert have the best kind of kidney systems to filter water and use it to its maximum. Actually, some organisms don't even drink water in a desert. They absorb and reabsorb all the water which comes from the food. And December 20th, we had flowers, probably the first advertising and marketing that was happening on the planet. It was invented way before us because plants were rooted in one place and they need to advertise that I'm here, hey, come and pollinate me. They are inviting pollinators
through color, through scent, and announcing their presence. Homo sapiens, so this is, they appeared on December 31st. Just note the time, just 24 minutes back is when we appeared in this calendar year. We had some very important innovations, which has helped our species in a big way. So agriculture, basically domesticating plants and animals for our good. But today, people are actually arguing that did we domesticate the plants and animals, or these grasses actually domesticated us? So it was actually a two-way process. We have always seen that we mastered them. And of course, we came up with Industrial Revolution, which all our current memory, our training, our education, our identities come from this 200-year-old, which is in this calendar year, just 2 seconds. So just 2 seconds back is when this happened, but this is what we identify with most. And if we need to learn anything, so this is the knowledge bank we always fall back on, that, you know, if I have to make a building, okay, which are the best buildings, which just happened this 2 seconds ago. If I have to innovate on a water challenge, how was it solved a few hundred years ago? But there are many innovations far before that, which our current education system doesn't help us navigate or learn from. So this is, to put it in a nutshell, this is what we all discussed. This is how this is how young we are. So this is just to give you this perspective that there are many other organisms which are much older. There are many challenges which were solved much earlier and have been evolving over billions and millions of years, not just the last 2 seconds or 200 years. And all that we did in this industrial age led to some unintended consequences. So consequences that we really didn't want, but we just didn't know how to do it in any other different way. So this led to what we are discussing today, climate change, biodiversity depletion, environmental pollution. And we argue it is also endemic poverty, waste, unemployment, chronic dependence and addiction on various things that we have created. And this is just a result of a bad design. This is not natural. This doesn't happen in the biological world. It doesn't happen in the natural world, but this happens in the human world.
Yeah, I would like to also add, for the last 2 years, we have been challenging people. If you ever find an unemployed plant or animal, please inform us, we'll give you a prize. Not a single one has been found. So don't take this seriously. This is a problem of bad human design. It's not a natural condition. We have invented unemployment. So that's also our invention, you know.
So, but this has influenced us in a big way. And this is another...
A lot of it has happened because we don't understand exponential growth. And our memories and the memory of our leader is based on historical, and historically we were growing rather slowly. If you see from 1500 to 1900, the human population growth was at a very, very shallow curve. And most of our attitudes, our habits, our sense of what works, what doesn't work, is habituated by those years. And after 1900, and especially after World War II, our growth suddenly has changed, but our memories and habits have not changed. We still feel that this will resolve itself. We are not understanding that this is not going to happen. I don't know how many of you heard the story that there was a king who used to love to play chess, and he had a big drought in his kingdom. And he said, anybody who will solve the drought problem, I'll give him whatever he wants. And the farmer solved his problem, and he called him to his kingdom, and he said, okay, what do you want? The farmer was intelligent. He said that I have to make the king commit in front of everybody, otherwise he can change his mind. So the farmer came with a single grain of sand, kept it on his chessboard. One. He said, sir, I just want one grain of sand for this little square For the next square, just make it 2. For the third square, make it 4. Like this till you're 64 square, that's all I want. So the king was like all of us. He did not understand exponential growth. He said, I am the king. Ask anything. You just want this sand. He says, no, no, sir. You commit. The king said, okay. And he said, get a bowl of rice and give this to guy, because he thought it will be at max a bowl. What do you think happened? Just do the math now. Even before they reached the 34th square, the entire grain in the world could not fill the requirement. The king had to sell his kingdom, become a slave, and still couldn't. That's exactly how human brain works. We don't understand exponential growth. We just do our budgeting, our growth 10% year on year, without understanding that when the base becomes untenable, we have a finite planet, but infinite ambitions. It doesn't work like that. There are limits and boundaries to everything. So we have reached a phase where the rules need to change. And let's also acknowledge it's 6th November. Isn't it unusual that we are talking business as usual? We are in the middle of a pandemic. There is a collective pause. I find the collective pause as a very big teacher also. What has it taught me? It has shown that before pre-COVID, and even right now, we are actually living like caterpillars. Just concentrating on eating, consuming, accumulating. And in that, we weren't paying attention. And there's a cost of not paying attention that we are all in this COVID. Why it has happened? Because I think a lot of us have now made the economy so central that we've started believing that we have to shape our environment, we have to shape our society to fit in and nourish the economy. Isn't it so? But what is the economy? Economy is our imagination. It's a servant. It's a tool which we created. And if your servant has become your master and you're not even remembering it, there is not much hope for us. We'll be just busy looking busy or busy doing busy work, but not making real progress. The real thing is that it is the ecology in whose service society should be made. So now is a good time to reflect. We have been living like caterpillars, hungry, eating. COVID has brought a little bit of pause. So what now? So we have seen how quickly we could pause our economic and social systems. Not because we realize that it is life that you cannot pause. Please try pausing your life. You can't pause life. Because life is the central reason. It is the master. Everything else. Why this is important? Because we have to understand the fundamental reason for biomimicry. Because it brings ecology as the overall framework within which we design our economy and our society. And this framework doesn't allow us to stop paying attention because it is happening within the framework of ecology. And we would argue business, politics, everything should start now within this framework, because when we are doing things, it's not possible to regularly pay attention if you have the wrong framework. But if you get the framework right, then it liberates you. Automatically, attention is part of your reference framework. So today we have a choice. And Gandhi said, speed is irrelevant if you're going in the wrong direction. We want to start by saying, COVID has showed us that we are in the wrong direction. And if we still continue racing, no fun in winning this race. You know, a scientist said, we are all in a big bus, which is heading for a ditch, and we are fighting for the window seat. So even if you get the window seat, we are all going to fall together. So time to reflect which is the right way to go. But I think all of us in our urgencies feel that all that is fine. It is really business which is the driving force today. And until as business changes, what can we do, right? The good news is that at least in the academic circles, business has started thinking differently. So earlier, all businesses would say that make money, do a little bit of philanthropy, do a hospital, something, all sins are forgiven. Then the era where we lived in, people said, no, 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 mandatorily you have to do corporate social responsibility. But now, at least in the academic circles,
they've started saying that humanity has reached a stage where the purpose of business itself should be to create shared value. Here's the important thing, shared value, just not for the stakeholders and humanity, but shared value for the planet, for all life. This is new, this is sensible, and this is something which we should promote and talk about it so that more of us know and create awareness that the purpose of business should be overall, creating conditions for all life. Because once you do that, the system will start becoming coherent. And why is it this important? Because let's be honest, while we have big problems, we also have great opportunities, unprecedented technologies, the kind of quantum computing, artificial intelligence, nanotechnology, additive manufacturing, biomimicry, that we never had these capabilities. And why am I talking? Because all these capabilities, we'll tell you, they enable mimicking nature, which probably earlier, 20 years ago, was not possible. Today, it's possible. We have the resources, we have the technology, we might not have the imagination. That's why biomimicry is important. We have to solve our problem of limited imagination. The rest is there. So quite interesting, a strange human species. At one point you have these amazing technologies. At another point you have these amazing problems, pandemic, climate change. The question is, what do you want to do with these technology? Most of us, because of problem of imagination, might be designing the next smartphone or some spaceship. Why don't we solve these problems of climate change, poverty, exclusion, waste? Everything is solvable. What we are looking for is the right design. And where do we look? We look at nature. So let's make a promise that this is what we will do with our new capabilities and create conditions conducive to life, all life. And it's time to revisit the common purpose that our development should not be just human-centered, not just economy-centered, not just technology-centered, but life-centered, life with a capital L. But how?
So this is where biomimicry comes in, that how do we do this is what is where we really face the challenge. Where do we find new ideas? And this is where the emerging field of biomimicry provides us with tools and methods to uncover these very sustainable ideas which have evolved and have been tested for a long time. So biomimicry officially defined, and this is a definition given by Janine Benyus Institute, that it's a conscious emulation of nature's genius, conscious implying it's really intended. It's not by chance, interest of a few, but anybody who wants to practice it can learn and put it into practice. Emulation is not a slavish copy, but really understanding the deep patterns of principles of nature and then engineering it with the kind of methods and the technology that we have and apply it to solve our current challenges. And nature's genius, of course, as we've discussed, it's been evolving for a far longer time. It's undergone a far more rigorous test of how the planet changes and how can you adapt to it. So, and biomimicry is practiced at many levels, form, process, and systems. And what do we mean by form? So form is anything you can see with your eye or measure, whether at a macro scale or at a micro scale. And let me explain that with an example here, which is, if you've heard of biomimicry, you must know this. This is the Shinkansen or the bullet train, which is coming, invented in Japan, actually it's coming in India also. And it was called the bullet train because the front of the train was shaped like a bullet because it is one of the most aerodynamic shape that we know. But that train had one problem, that every time it would go through a tunnel, every time it would come out, it created a sonic boom. And it was very disturbing for the people working or living around that area. So an engineer was tasked to solve this, and he happened to be an avid bird watcher. And one day he saw a kingfisher bird, which actually goes vertically in the water to catch its prey. It's a fish. And every time it would enter the water, it didn't create a splash. So it made him think, am I not trying to solve exactly this, that when the train is coming from one medium of density of a material into another, it shouldn't create this splash. So he mimicked this shape it underwent a lot of wind tunnel tests and he realized it really works. It did solve that problem. So this is a mimicry of a form to solve a certain function. And he went on to use inspiration from owl's feather and a penguin to solve the vibration and the noise in the pantograph of the same train. And the next level of practicing biomimicry is emulating the processes in nature. So it's not just the form that you see, but also how are they made? What is the manufacturing that is happening in nature? So in nature, everything is made at ambient temperature and pressure in body, because every egg, every embryo is actually conceived in a living body. There is no factory, there is no assembly line, there is no transportation of material. So if we are intelligent enough to mimic these forms, can we also mimic the way nature makes things? So this is really, so we're going to show you many examples in the second part of our presentation on how this is being done. And the third level is really mimicking or emulating ideas from nature at a systems level. That this kingfisher bird, which has made its beak in a certain shape at ambient temperature and pressure, is part of a larger ecosystem or a forest where it lives. It actually takes resources from it. It also gives out certain resources, whether it's waste, it's a byproduct from its body or, you know, its feathers, but it doesn't create any damage to that ecosystem. It is part of a larger system without creating any conflict. So whenever we are designing a product or a process, how can it become part of a larger system without creating any conflict or depleting its resources? So, and true biomimicry is really realized if you practice it at all three levels, not just form, process, or system. So we'd like to just stop here and just hear from you if you have any questions, you have any comments or anything you would like to share before we move on.
Yeah, also we were told that it's a good place to have a bio break for some of you. So, you know, if there are some.
It's biomimicry, so you need a bio.
So we'll probably spend 5 to 10 minutes on questions.
So Mercy, Michael, if there are any questions.
Yeah, thank you so much for the first half of the session. Really insightful. People have been engaging on the chat. Interesting concepts, new concepts to most of us. So we've had a couple of questions coming in. So someone is just asking, if biomimicry holds the solution, why or what challenges are there in us trying to implement some of these solutions for people probably in the impact ecosystem? So what challenges stand between us and implementation of some of the solutions that are provided to us by nature?
Yeah, so I think to be very practical, one of the biggest challenges to find resources to develop biomimicry to a level where, it can engage and start transforming both our economy. And so one of the big challenges is resources, like a seed. You know, a seed can be in a jar in your kitchen, but if you put it in the right soil with the right nutrition, it becomes an oak tree. So right now we are all like seeds. We are looking for somebody to give us the soil and nutrition.
I think the other biggest challenge is that it is a multidisciplinary field. It cannot be practiced alone by a designer or by a biologist or by a business person. It needs a lot of collaborative approach, which unfortunately most of us are not trained how to come together from different fields, like a biologist sitting with a product designer to develop something. They don't even talk the same language. And, you know, institutes collaborating with each other to come up with a truly multidisciplinary approach, because most of us have left our life sciences study, you know, in school somewhere. If you take up engineering, you are told biology is not relevant to you. If you're an architect, you're told, you know, you don't have to study biology. So we have to collaborate with a biologist to actually have insight into what are the best ideas I can borrow from, how is this interpreted. So I think that
as a beginning is a big challenge. You do need some training in the field of biomimicry to be able to practice it. Receiving that training could be the first challenge as well. And like any product development, it does need resources, as Prashant said, so, and time. And you know, allowance for failure. So I think we need all of that to be able to innovate.
Yeah, also awareness is limited. People, we still find a lot of people think biomimicry is another fancy word. It's a new fashion accessory like sustainability. It'll come and go. To understand it deeply requires maybe, you know, mainstream media needs to help pick it up. So these are issues. At a human behavior level, we sometimes find that because people are unfamiliar and people have built their identity around siloed, you know, that an expert in engineering, there is some resistance that what is this new word? If this becomes popular, then who am I? So I think all of us have to put our heads together and see how do we create biomimicry? Like we would like to say biomimicry should be like sugar in water. It should dissolve and become part of human nature. But resources critically, I think if I was to say what is immediate, resources should be put in this direction.
Yeah, great. And so, I mean, you used a really great timescale example that you referred to a year comparing the evolution of the world using 1 year. So what does the future hold? If biomimicry is not implemented, probably most of us would know or would guess what the future holds. But if say now we've mixed that biomimicry concept into society, so what does the future look like with biomimicry?
Yeah, can we hold on to this question? Because after the next session, some of these questions will be answered.
Great.
Let me give you a clue.
Okay.
We are part of nature. Mm-hmm. So if we are conscious, then we will have a happy journey. If we are haphazard, then we'll have a not so happy journey. But eventually biomimicry is inevitable. You can hold me to that at the end of the presentation.
Yes, I'll do so. And so what are some of the effective ways in which biomimicry has been integrated into day-to-day life? I know you've given us the example of the mockingbird. So what other examples are there in the day-to-day life and probably more specifically in the development sector?
So the second part of our talk is really showing you a lot of case studies on how various products and processes are already are done by many famous companies, not just, so whether you take some of the best companies like Procter & Gamble, Nike, Kimberly-Clark, they are already taking some of these ideas and using it, whether even Volvo car, even Boeing aeroplane. So we are going to show you some examples which we thought are relevant. You'll see that in part two.
Great. So maybe one last question before we get into part two. And this is a question coming from an attendant. What industry or type of stakeholders that you have seen are most open? That are most open to picking up biomimicry concepts.
Yeah, actually, in our limited reach, you know, because we have only been teaching in colleges in India, the strongest spontaneous has come from industrial designers, the design community, the architects, industrial designers, product designers. And there's been a very good level of interest from mechanical engineers, more than other engineering. That has been very, very high. My guess is because there is a certain immediacy to what they can use to give them economic benefits. So for example, today, mechanical engineers have to look at additive manufacturing, at new softwares which are mimicking bones. And so they find it very relevant. And the design community, there has been a very, very good response.
But this is, but to be honest, this is one field, as we keep saying, we didn't expect the kind of response we got right from the school to a corporate level and everything in between. I mean, we didn't expect it when we went out talking about this field, but at some level, everybody's interested and everybody sees sense in it, whether it's a ninth grader or, you know, an architecture student or a practicing engineer or, you know, even a biologist themselves. They also wonder, like, why aren't we interacting with the world outside so much? And I need a bridge to talk to other people. And maybe biomimicry professionals will be that bridge where I'm able to talk to people outside of, you know, the small lab that I'm working in. So everybody sees sense in it, but they just don't know how to practice it. So that has been really their problem. But as Prashant said, engineers and designers with this one website available to them called Ask Nature, they feel they have something in hand to use it immediately. So they feel most comfortable to practice it right away. The others feel they need some help, but they are very interested.
Yeah, but let me also say one thing. You know, I think Seema said a very right thing. It is also dependent on the opportunities of deep engagement that we ourselves have got. So every time we've got very few opportunities to deal with depth with corporates or business. But even in those opportunities, the interest level was extremely high. So maybe how to increase the number of opportunities where biomimicry is taken to the business people to that will give us a true sense. Because right now the sample is actually maybe unfair because the number of opportunities we get with design is almost 70% or engineers is 70 to 80%. So, but the outcome of each engagement is extremely good with business. Only how do we increase that opportunity? Traditionally, business has stayed away from workshops or biomimicry or these kinds. So we need to start looking at this. We are trying to work on it, but we feel that that right now it might be premature to say that this is maximum interest because the other sector has not been exposed to this education.
Great, and that's just a really nice segue into maybe my last question. So, I mean, the world is run by government corporates, and that's the reality of it, right? So, I mean, these institutions tend to be very myopic, and so, I mean, it just leads one to wonder where will this kind of long-term vision kind of take root in the situation that we find ourselves in.
Yeah, ideally, I think this should become a non-negotiable, fundamental part of our education system for everybody, not just for engineers, architects, politicians, for everybody. It might take time, but I think just like, you know, to drive a scooter, we need a license. Now humanity has come to a stage where actually we are driving the planet and we have no clue how the planet works. So this should be a mandatory license to participate in society and economy. We need to understand life's principles. So our hope is that this will become, how to become an earthling is more important to become how to become a successful economic person. See, what's the point? Even if you became the richest person and died in pollution, what's the big deal? So we got to realize, and by the way, the world might not be run by so many big institutions. Right now, COVID is running the world. And it's not even a full life, it's a half life. So I hope this humility stays with us. And we realize that eventually we are all linked together. Nobody can thrive in isolation. And
our personal right now hope is that we are able to push this idea in school education through policy changes so that it truly becomes part of the culture. Like that's how people think. That's how they approach problem solving. That's how they approach innovation. So, you know, so that is our hope that that's when it becomes part of the culture without really influencing from the top. It's bottom up, you know, it's a bottom up change.
Right. And maybe before we move to the next segment of this masterclass, we thought there was quite an interesting commentary on the chat box, where one of the attendees was actually saying, you know, nature has taken a very long time to learn from itself, but yet we are trying to understand this in, you know, a 2-hour session. I thought that was a humbling comment. And so maybe your thoughts while we lead to the next segment of the masterclass.
Please read this as a provocation. We're just trying to share the screen. Can you see the screen? Can you give us a thumbs up? Can you see the screen?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So now let's go to the more, how do we engage with the industrial economy? So bringing biomimicry into the current ways of our life and thinking. So our current ways of life are governed by certain processes, parameters, and formats in which we plan, we operationalize, and we manage our systems. So the first thing is that we need to look at the benchmarks and the parameters which, or the framework within which we operate. Whether you are an engineer, an architect, or a politician, usually we set up certain goals. So we set up an aspirational goal or a mentor. For example, you could say that I want, you know, all humans to become like Einstein, or I want all, I'm just giving an example, please don't take it literally, or I want my city to become like Las Vegas or whatever. So the first thing is we have to start establishing natural mentors. So for example, if we say we want our cities to operate like bioregional forest, that let the city also behave like it was a forest which belonged to this region. Now that's important because then it starts dictating how we are doing, or there are companies which are saying, let my factory feel like a forest floor. So that's one thing, to create mentors based out of nature. And then usually we look at models that, okay, how do you want your filtration system, or how do we, so there also it is better to identify native or local living systems on which you model your processes. Why is that important? Because these are intrinsically place-based. Often we go for the best, but that best might not be the systemic fit for that particular bioregion. So modeling it on nature helps us de-risk ourselves. Does it have to be a complete emulation? Not necessarily, but it gives you a certain framework. And then most important, for anything that humanity does, we say that whatever you cannot measure, you cannot manage, at least in the current ways of thinking, that's true. So we need to create certain measurable benchmarks. So these are, a lot of it actually is has now been done in biomimicry. So these are called life's principles, or you know, sometimes we call ecological performance standards. So these are measurable parameters which look at nature functionally, so that we can start measuring that whatever innovation or development we are doing, is it out of sync with nature or is it with sync with nature? And more importantly, is it going to be place-based? So these are three framework measures which will help the system start moving towards a better integration with the bioregion.
Okay, so we, I think as some of you have rightly said, how is this being applied in the real world? So we will take you through 5 questions, and for each we are going to show you some fundamental differences between how nature really approaches these challenges, which are also is a challenge in the human world. So whether you take a challenge like sustainable procurement of materials or sustainable design, Now, we have this challenge. We think this is a human challenge, but it's also a challenge in the natural world. So what is nature's fundamental principles to solve this? And this will be followed by a case study from a real world that how biomimicry was used as an approach to solve this. So let's start by, we always want to emphasize, you know, that there is a big disconnect from the ancient knowledge system to our current system, which actually culturally approached any problem solving just the way we are talking about in the natural world. So this was, you take any native culture, this was part of how people used to think and approach any problem at hand. So they would think of 10 generations ahead, not just one generation, not just immediate problem solving, but how would my 10th generation survive if I take this decision? So how do you make this part of this culture? So we'll take this question that what can we learn from living systems about procurement and use of resources? So nature really values what is most abundant and locally available. So this is like first fundamental difference between how nature does things and how we do things. So we value what is scarce, whether it's fossil fuel or various metals, which are probably scarce in the planet. We value that. We do not, and nature runs on solar. That is the most abundant form of energy. So that's the form of energy nature uses. So this is like one of the principles which help us, help us realize where are we going wrong? You know, how do we do things the way nature does? So nature uses a local small subset of elements. What that really means is if you look at a periodic table, which has about 100 plus elements, our world is made from, uses almost all of those elements. So 100 plus, some of them might be very toxic too. Whereas if you look at all living organisms, whether it's a small leaf, to an insect, to a bird body, to our own body, they are made up of fundamentally just 28 elements. And the size of the font on this slide is actually the amount of each of these materials or the group of material is used. So carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, and oxygen is primarily everything in the world is made out of these four basic materials. And that's how there is no waste. Material can move from one organism to another seamlessly. It can even move across ecosystems because everything is basically made of the same material. So this is one of, so green chemistry, if you've heard of this term, I'm sure you all have. The entire approach is to shift the way we make things, simplify it to materials that are abundant, processes which are more natural. And this is where it really stems from. So this is one example of biomimicry, how it is being practiced to realize this approach. How will we procure materials in our world? So this is about a material that we obviously relate to a great deal of pollution and climate change, which is cement manufacturing. So if you go to any cement plant, it doesn't take a lot to imagine it must be throwing out a lot of fume, and it is using a lot of fossil fuel to make cement, which is our basic building block. Most of our cities, buildings today all over the world are made with this one material. And how we really make it is we mine limestone, burn it at a very high temperature using fossil fuel. So we are actually releasing a lot of carbon, which was trapped geologically in the fossil fuel. We are putting it back into the air. And that's how we have excess carbon in our atmosphere to make a material which we want to build with. And if you look at nature, whether it's a plant or these coral reefs, they have actually been taking this carbon out of the atmosphere to make their, to use it as a building material for their bodies. So a coral uses excess carbon dioxide in seawater, which is an abundant resource, to make its hard biomineralized water body, which is calcium carbonate, limestone. So this is how, many engineers have learned from this. So there's a company called Blue Planet, who's now making cement just like corals. So they're taking this recipe. They are actually taking excess carbon dioxide coming out of cement factories themselves, passing it through brine or saline water. By change of pH, they are making a material which has the same properties as Portland cement. But now with this process, by emulating this process, they are actually, for every ton of cement they are making, they're sequestering half a ton of carbon from atmosphere, which conventionally, if you look at Portland cement, for every ton of cement that you make, you release a ton of carbon dioxide. So now they are taking back carbon and putting it and locking it back into the material. And that is what will lead to reversing of climate change. So being net positive, you know, all these terms that you hear, this is an emulation from nature, a process being mimicked from nature that helps you be net positive. So this is an example of not material this time, but procuring services. So nature also needs a lot of services, whether it's cleaning, pollination. So there is a huge service industry in the natural world. If you go to a forest, there is service being exchanged in different ways. And the currency for that is symbiotic relationship. You know, you do something, you benefit me and I benefit you. So they, what you see on the right side is an ox on whom a lot of these birds are sitting. They are actually feeding on its wax, a lot of mites on its body. So that's their food, but they are in return, they are giving a cleaning service to this organism. And what you see on the left is another kind of a service industry. This is a cactus in Arizona desert. It's called saguaro. It's a really a tall, unique cactus. In a desert, you don't have too many options for pollination and spreading your seeds. So it has developed or evolved a symbiotic relationship with migrating bats. So every year there are bats from North America that go down to Mexico in winters and then go back to North America in summers. So every time they are going to Mexico, they actually feed on the fruit of this cactus. So this is their stopover meal during migration. And during that meal, they actually spread the seeds of this plant. And when they're going back is the exact time these cactus flower. And again, it's a stopover meal to feed on the nectar and pollinate its flowers. So they have been helping each other survive. For many years because of this relationship. So you will find many of these cooperating, collaborative relationships in the natural world. So there are weeds, there is a lot of competition in the natural world, but those relationships are very short-lived. If you want to survive for a longer time, you need collaboration. Those relationships last much longer. So these are some of the principles to learn from, whether you are in a business world or you're starting your own business. You know, if you want to last for a long time, it's collaboration that will lead to that outcome, not competition. What can we learn from living systems about design of products, processes, and systems? So design, how does natural systems, you know, solve this challenge of what we call design? So nature invests a lot in shape and information, not material. Materials are same, those 28 basic material, but by adding a lot of shape and information, that means if you look at your own body, the skin cells is actually just one type of cell, but it does various functions from the scalp to the bottom of your foot. You know, the skin texture keeps changing by just change of density. The function keeps changing. So by just one material, add more shape, add more information and solve different challenges. Nature's design are really multifunctional. So if you see our skin, it is our biggest touch organ. It also thermally regulates our skin. It's a protection for the inside of a body from outside. So many functions built into one system. And And optimal utilization of resources. So that, Prashant, would you like to explain this?
Yeah, optimal usage. If you see in nature, you'll hardly find any resource being idle. There is no sense of locking away resources. Even a lion, if it's in its territory, there'll be other species which are also using that territory. They might be different. But after the lion goes, somebody else comes to the territory. Why? Because resources are limited and life has learned that, you know, you can't lock away resources. I say that even see the sophistication of design. Life is not even encouraging you to keep your genetic resources locked. So if you do inbreeding, your gene pool actually weakens. So this entire idea of unlocking resources. So let's look at the way humanity has designed its culture. Our culture is that if I am own something, it could be my house, it could be my car. If I'm not using it, nobody else can use it. So 95% of the time, 90% of humanity's cars are lying parked. Now let's look at this logic and go to every artifact humanity has created. You will realize that most of our artifacts are lying idle nearly 80 to 90% of the time. The chair you're sitting on. Now to us, this is bad design. And this is an opportunity to become, to unlock the multifunctionality, also multiple usages of our design. Not that it's maximum along one function, but it's optimal along various functions because resources are limited. Now, I want to take this opportunity to, this is not exotic. In a sense, somebody had asked the question, where are we headed? In a haphazard way, we have started doing that. If you look at what are the new business models, co-working spaces, carpool sharing, bread and breakfast, the sharing economy, intellectually thought of, but really they are mimicking, they are optimizing the use of a resource which has already had an investment of energy and material. So that's another big principle of nature. And that sometimes makes us feel that we actually live in a planet of abundance, imprisoned by the wrong imagination. If we start designing as per nature, we can create abundance within the resources we have.
I think even in terms of design, if you see our cell phone now, earlier, you know, one watch, one use, one phone, one use. So we are moving. So that's a natural progression. We are finding multi-use to the kind of products we are making. So our cell phone is our bank today. It's the way we, it's our living, it's our portable computer. It's our alarm clock. It's, you know, our, it's how we measure various, it's a medic, actually monitors our body functioning. So, you know, many functions built into one product is nature's way of doing things.
And the interesting thing is the cell phone in terms of material might be much less than the pager we used to have maybe 20 years ago. So less material, much more functionality. Let's use that logic and look at our world and certainly there could be abundance. So at multifunctional and multi-usage, you know, most of our schools, if you see a school building with all its equipment and everything is basically lying unused nearly 80% of the time. Do the calculation. There are 2 month holidays every weekend, then it works. And we say we have less schools. How do we reimagine it that nothing goes idle where there has been an investment of energy and material? So these are opportunities. We don't have the answers, but we at least know where to look.
So this is a biomimicry example of how design is being done using ideas from nature. So this was a concept car by Mercedes. Its shape was inspired by this yellow fish that you see on top. It's called a box fish. And its shape was used not only because it's very suitable, you know, to design a car with certain capacity, but also because aerodynamically it's a very stable shape. In very turbulent environments also, this fish is very stable. So besides using the shape, they also wanted to go a step further by using less material to design, to make this car. So in order to do that, they approached a biologist who was studying tree structures, who has been studying tree structures for almost 2 decades now. He is in Germany. His name is Klaus Mathick. And he designed a software where he took algorithms on how tree distributes its load. And using
just the optimum amount of material. So that software was used to design this car, and they actually ended up using almost one third less material and making it even more fuel efficient by using less material. So that we move on to the next question, that how can we learn from living systems about manufacturing and construction? So very relevant to any business or design world. So nature really makes, as I already mentioned, everything is made in body at ambient temperature and pressure. So anything in nature, because it has to be made in a living body, firstly, it cannot be toxic. What you read on the right seat is water-based chemistry, non-toxic. You cannot use high temperature and pressure. So you look at any mammal, including us, when we have babies, they are actually being manufactured in a body. Life cannot afford to make anything in a toxic way. And there is no factories in the natural world. It's not like a shell was, you know, made in another factory. The mollusk was brought from somewhere else and the shell was kind of assembled and, you know, bolted onto it. So that doesn't happen in the natural world. So how can we change our manufacturing? And you know, we always see in the natural world, materials are very soft, very organic. We give it various adjectives, but there are natural materials are also very strong. They are very adaptable. They are very elastic. They are also as hard as this shell that you see on the right. These are limpets. They are one of the toughest materials that are found on the shores. Or you see a spider silk. If you take a thread of a spider silk and the same dia of thread you take in steel, it actually has more tensile strength. So nature, and how was that made? It was made by a spider just eating a few flies, not using fossil fuel, not mining things from anywhere. So what can we learn from simple materials like them, and how can we mimic this manufacturing? And what can we learn from living systems about maintenance or managing anything that is made once, it has to be maintained, whether it's physical repair, or in a system, how do you keep things in check? You know, everything works perfectly. So it has to be. So nature really, everything is self-assembled. There is self-healing, self-repair. There is self-maintenance. There is diversity and decentralization. A great example of that is our own immune system, which is, there is firstly an investment in every organism to maintain or protect it from the various infections or attacks or unpredictable changes that might happen in its lifetime. So our body undergoes these attacks from a bacteria or a virus over our lifespan. Yeah, this attack can be from our mouth. It could be also from a cut in the foot. It could be a bone getting broken somewhere. So we have an immune system. So the white blood cells, which are decentralized, they are many different types distributed all over our body to give us that resilience. So to repair on its own. If our skin gets cut today, it actually just blood coagulates and it repairs on its own. So this is self-repair, self-heal. But when we make products or we make design a city, we don't think that how will this product repair itself, if it undergoes some kind of a damage. We don't design for that. That is not part of our design brief. If we make a city, we don't design that, okay, if tomorrow there is a grid failure, how will this city be resilient to this kind of a failure or this disturbance? Tomorrow, if there is unexpected flooding, how will the city survive? So today with climate change, we have realized that we are discussing it. It's becoming part of our design brief, but it wasn't for the longest time. So this is what we can learn from nature. So you see these examples of a lotus leaf. These are two examples of self-cleaning. Okay, so anything in the natural world needs cleaning, like any human product. And lotus leaf, which if you've ever seen it, it grows in a very muddy environment. And it has to keep itself clean in order to photosynthesize well. So, and it does it not by by design, but it has evolved a texture on its leaf surface, which at a microscopic level is very rough. So you see this on the photograph on top here. This is a photograph under an electron microscope. It's extremely rough, so much so that any water droplet or dirt particles that might settle on the leaf actually don't never touch the leaf. They are floating in air. And because they are floating, every time there's a breeze, the leaf will tilt. The water which is settled on the leaf will float, carrying all the dirt particles with it. So this texture inspired some textiles, paint companies to use the same similar texture to keep things clean with just a wash of water. Or the image that you see on the right is actually a shark. It's a very slow moving shark in the sea called Galapagos shark. It keeps itself clean from bacteria, which always settles on any surface that is stable or, you know, slow in water. But it doesn't on the shark skin. And that's again because of design. Because of shape and information and no new material. How we deal with bacteria is disinfectants, chemicals, antibiotics. But here, bacteria is kept away by just the design of the skin, microscopic design. So this is the design that you see, the image right above the shark. It is, again, is designed in a way that the bacteria cannot find a foothold on the skin. Because it cannot find a foothold, it cannot multiply and form a biofilm on top, which is one of the key problems we face in hospitals. Every time you go touch surfaces on any in any public building, chances are you're picking up somebody's else's infection. So there's a company called Sharklet, which has taken this texture, put it on films and coatings, like spray coatings, where you put it on any surface, it will not allow biofilms to form on it. So a simple solution inspired by nature to keep surfaces clean. An example of self-heal. So this is a rhino horn. It's a non-living tissue, but this horn grows only once on the rhino, in a rhino's body. And it undergoes a lot of micro cracks, you know, in its lifetime. And every time there's a crack, there is no doctor which comes to repair it. What happens is there is a protein mix inside. It just releases itself in the crack and fills it up instantly. So this idea was mimicked by a scientist. What she did is every time you lay concrete, you embed certain resin capsules in the concrete itself. That whenever there's a micro crack, these capsules will break open, release that resin mix and fill up the crack on its own, then and there, instantly, not waiting for a larger crack to happen and then the repair to take place. So these are simple ideas that how can we increase the longevity of any product if this is part of a design brief, that every time your cell phone falls, the screen should just repair itself. You know, every time a piece of furniture breaks, how will it just repair on its own? And lastly, what can we learn from living systems about managing waste? Well, there is no such thing as waste in the natural world. So if you see any soil web, if there is a branch of tree that falls today on the ground for any reason, you will see in a few days there is a fungus growing on it, which starts breaking it down into smaller particles. So this fungus might be eaten by an arthropod. So the material which was a branch or wood becomes part of the fungus body. The fungus is eaten by an arthropod, it becomes part of the arthropod's body. The arthropod might be eaten by a bird, it becomes part of the bird body. The bird might die tomorrow, its body will again break down and become part of the soil, which will nourish probably the next tree. So it's just a broad example to show you how material is moving. The same material, it's not is moving across organisms, can even move across ecosystems seamlessly in a closed loop. There is no landfill. There is no linear system that leads to a product which cannot be used. And this idea is mimicked in an eco-industrial park. The photograph, the graphic that you see on the right of this soil web, it just shows you in this eco-industrial park, which is in Denmark, there was a coal-fired power plant, which is considered the most polluting industry in the world. And it is considered a polluting industry because it has a lot of byproducts that traditionally we don't know what to do with it. So it ends up, you know, going into a landfill. It has excess heat, excess steam, clinker, gypsum. So what they have done here is they have placed industries next door which can use these byproducts to make another product which is of use. Like the clinker is being used by a road building company, which takes this byproduct and makes roads with it. And they might have a byproduct which another industry can use. So they close the loops like that for every byproduct so that there is no such thing as waste in this entire industrial park. And there is a company called Interflow Carpets, who are the pioneers of using biomimicry and bio-inspired ideas for transforming their business. You must check them out. So one of the ways they've used biomimicry is they have hired a lot of fishermen in Indonesia who were out of jobs because fishing is banned, to collect old fish nets from sea. And fish nets contribute to almost 10% plastic waste in seawater, because fishermen all over the world, once the fish net loses its shape or is torn, they are just thrown into the sea. So they are being paid to collect these old fish nets from the sea, clean them, tie them, and supply it to their company, because fish nets are made of nothing but nylon, which is one of the biggest raw materials that any carpet manufacturing industry needs. So they are mining a useful material from waste rather than virgin material. And that's how they, and you know, giving work to communities, involving communities who are out of jobs. So this is a new way of thinking that how we can see value in products that were discarded by us and bringing them back into the loop rather than throwing them into marine waters or soils or, you know, other water bodies and creating problems for other life forms. So I hope that there are many, many more examples. If you're really interested to know more, this was just a snapshot on how people are using these ideas. So there's a website called asknature.org where there are more than 150, 200 products inspired by nature that are given in detail. Please do look them up if that interests you. And what we are trying to convey through this short session is that if you procure material and services, design, manufacture, maintain, integrity or functional health of anything in our world, manage end of the functional life of any product, as nature does, we can create abundance and sustainability, which often we wonder, how are we going to achieve it? So to make it more vivid, make it more achievable, this is a way to do it.
So yeah, and I'm sure mostly we've been asked, okay, this is fine, but is biomimicry being accepted? And that was a question. So the good news is that at a level wherever we've been able to get an opportunity to take biomimicry workshops, this has probably been the most successful program in terms of going through various disciplines, engineering colleges, design colleges, business colleges, fashion design, mainstream industry, children's schools, as well as multidisciplinary cohort. So there is demonstrated successful evidence and ongoing work where biomimicry has been embraced by all the workshops that we have done. We've done more than 145. These are some of the places where we have engaged, and there is much more happening. We understand you need to see them because you must be wondering, is it really working? And also just very, very fast, because we are running short of time, a glimpse of our student works. So this was a project where we had a group of students who were wanting to design potato chip packaging. And they started by saying, let's make it biodegradable. But when they look at nature, they realize that nature is way more sophisticated. A banana actually tells you exactly when its contents are going rotten. While our packaging has a dump print of an expiry date, and often 20 to 30% of our food is unnecessarily wasted because the date is saying expired, but the food might be good. So here was a challenge. Can you design packaging which gives you a real-time indication? So they looked at how nature works, and they worked on packaging which changed color. Similarly, we had a group of students wondering how come these African wild dogs have such high success rate in their hunts, and how come they are able to be so effective as a team? Because we all know we have a problem in working in a team, and how do they build trust? Actually, the real functional question was how to build trust. And they realized that how the use of play and multi-sensory experience of the team enables building of trust, where in unprecedented or sudden situations, you have to work together. And they developed an app and a game. Similarly, we had another group which came up with the problem of gender equality. And believe me, we ourselves said that maybe it's too big for biomimicry. And they actually were able to look at mycelium networks and came up with a solution for gender equality. We don't have the time to go into detail, but I want to leave you with a provocation that biomimicry is way more relevant than we think. And it will take your own personal engagement. Similarly, we've had other more obvious things where how do you learn from a cat to create, in disaster management, we throw supplies and often they land and break. But can you just by using design inspired by a cat create gunny bags which will land softly? So this was one project. Another project that, coastal regions will be subjected to floods and climate change. Can we create boundary walls which will actually dissolve and reform themselves as rafts inspired by fire ants? This was an amazing project by students. Then another project where barrels were redesigned in hexagonal shape, because a lot of our crude oil and other stuff goes in barrel. And not only is there inefficient use of material, but also there is a high incidence of breakage because of vibrational load. And they designed a hexagonal structure, which they actually put through a simulation and test. Then they realized with less material, they achieved less breakage. Then there's been a lot of projects on water, that how does nature manage water and how do our cities manage water, and how learning from forest ecosystems, we can design a much more resilient urban planning where there'll be less incidences of both water shortage as well as water accumulation. This was again an amazing project, which actually I think went on to probably interest some investors and R&D people, were inspired by the kidney of a kangaroo rat, which doesn't waste any molecule of water because it doesn't drink water. It gets all its water from food. It is able to do extreme filtration and use the water in its system. Some students in Ahmedabad University designed a filtration system. So there were many other projects. I won't go through all of them, but we have been amazed. We often go to some science conferences and people say, where do you get new ideas from? And in all humility, we do feel like saying, come to our workshops. You'll have more than enough ideas flowing. And why don't you try it out and see how it unlocks our worldview of possibilities?
But having said that, it will be incomplete to leave it at this. One of the most important thing about biomimicry is that biomimicry tries to restore our education and practice to become holistic, not just purely intellectual and solving problems which have an economic outcome, but also to acknowledge and integrate ethics as well as our deep connection with nature. It is only when we do all three, then true biomimicry happens. And in our current cultural fit, often these two things have been neglected. And we feel that if we neglect it again, then we'll again create a dysfunctional society. It might be maybe doing very well on one dimension, maybe material dimension, but it might not do well as a holistic planetary species. So we need to do all three. Ethos, it's very simple. Create conditions conducive for life, all life. Reconnect, not just intellectual and economic outcome. Restore, go out in nature and restore your emotional connect with nature. It is as important, if not more, than the intellectual. Only when we do all these three, true biomimicry will happen. So where does biomimicry fit in? Everywhere. But as somebody asked the question, why is it difficult to happen? Because right now we are operating in silos. Our education, our institutions are working in silos. Nature doesn't care about physics, chemistry, technology, politics. Nature is about phenomena and patterns. And to be able to work in terms of phenomena and pattern, we need to start developing the ability to work across disciplines. And that's what biomimicry requires. And a little bit of systems thinking helps facilitate that collaboration. And the big shift is from being human-centered to being life-centered. Life with a capital L, all life. And of course, we are mortal, small human beings. Don't trust us. Just check back. So many of our most brilliant and revered scientists and thinkers have always been saying that. It's just that it took us biomimicry to get it. So it's always been told to us, and now biomimicry has become a way where we can start really understanding and using it. So let's come back to that question. We are at a pause. We have a choice. What do we do? Where do we look? I think let's rise. It's time, it's an opportunity for humanity to rise, and biomimicry can be the lighthouse to guide us in the journey. Let's now build a society which is in alignment with nature. And I know it will take us time to have all the answers, but at least we can make one commitment today. Let's add one question, one habit of the mind, like we brush our teeth every day. One small question we can add to our daily habits. And that is to say, what would nature do here? Whether you're a politician or you're sweeping the toilet, at least ask the question. Answers might come later, but let's promise to make this question a new habit of our mind. What would nature do here?
Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Seema and Prashant. A really insightful conversation that we've just had. What would nature do? I mean, that's the big question, right? Thank you so much for the session. I have just one question as we close, because I know we have about less than 7 minutes. So, I mean, with the enterprises that you've listed to us, what has been the experience in them trying to source funding from these traditional financiers, the VCs, the PEs? What has been their experience dealing with the traditional financiers? We can answer that and wrap up with that question.
Sorry, what did you say? What has been our experience with
the experience of enterprises that are trying to propel this biomimicry concept? So what has been the experience in trying to source financing from traditional financiers?
Yeah, to our experience, our personal experience has been, to put it mildly, not very successful. We have had to use our personal resources and personal funds to build whatever we have built up now. Often we have done
done events which have funded from our own resources and arranged. But this is a critical thing. You know, any change which is new to the system would need to find resources and funding. We have approached, and we are hoping that as awareness grows and as
I would add that we started teaching. We didn't, when we studied biomimicry, which was way back in 2011. What happened? That time people were not, at least here in India, were not at all aware of this approach.
So we realized we'll have to do a lot of, we have to spread awareness about it. And the best way that came to us was teaching in institutions. It was, an organized way of teaching this subject and spreading awareness. But I would say since 2011, it was because there was a lot of positive response from the students and wherever we went that kept us going. And now the awareness is far more. I think because we are having this session today here itself, it wouldn't have been possible 5-6 years ago. So there is a lot more awareness. People realize and see the value and the need, and there are a lot more successful products since then in the market, which stand evidence that this approach is valuable and is possible. But to make anything new commercially viable and to get enough funding to do more and more research and to promote any field, I think those resources are is the bottleneck. That, okay, we brought it to this level. How do we scale it up? How do we really take it to many more people and maybe start real research in some products or incubate certain products? So that always takes time, and we are hoping there'll be a lot more interest by institutes or organizations who give grants for such sustainable methods. So they would see much more value in it than is being currently seen. So that is our hope.
Yeah, but with the last 8 years of experience, if I or we were to give any recommendation, we would say a serious allocation of resources is required, because otherwise there can be fatigue in the system. A lot of us, not only us, there are people in various countries who've been using their own resources. And the great part is that the participants and learners, they are absolutely in line and their eyes light up. But if we want to change the established institutions, that is going to take a lot of time. So finding resources to maybe create an independent channel of learning and ensuring that resources go to the people who've been working on that would go a long way. Because it's like the customer is ready, the product is ready, but the established distribution network is not willing to change very fast. That's the truth of reality. We get so many emails from students, but how do you reach those students?
Great, and hopefully the conversation is going to grow and the awareness is also going to grow moving forward. So thank you so much for the session, Seema and Prashant. For everyone who's attended, please visit the Launchpad booth. There are a couple of enterprises there that are implementing this biomimicry concept. For more information on biomimicry, you can visit their website or you can visit the exhibition that is also in the umbrella platform. Thank you so much for attending. Thank you so much, Prashant and Seema. I'm looking forward to continuing interactions in this subject and continuing interactions within the summit as we wrap up the last day. Thank you so much and have a great rest of the summit. Bye.
Thank you, Michael and Mercy, for doing a great job. And thank you everybody for taking time to be with us. Hopefully you enjoyed and you've learned something new today.
Thank you. And please don't forget to ask, what would nature do here?
What would nature do? Thank you for the people that have attended. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.